Hi, it's Kiffin Lobates here, and today I want to talk about backdoors in smart contracts. And the reason why I'm tackling this topic today is because Thomas Lukasik pointed me to something that has come to light in the NFT smart contract world fairly recently. It turns out that about 30 different projects have hired the same smart contract developer off Fiverr for the cost of about $3,000 per company or organization to deploy their NFT contracts. So that developer has made in the region of $100,000 in the last few months just by deploying some simple NFT contracts. And it makes me think that maybe I should have priced my smart contract work a little bit higher. But anyway, back to this developer. What it turns out is that the developer has added a backdoor to every single one of these NFT contracts. And it's an incredibly simple backdoor. It is literally 12 characters added to one standard library off OpenZeppelin that gives them control over the NFT contracts, even when it looks like they've relinquished it. So maybe to explain how this functions, when you have a smart contract, it has a bunch of functions that you can call, and some of them are viewing functions which return data. So for an NFT contract, there's a function called URI, and when you call that, it tells you the web server or the interplanetary file system folder where the metadata and the JPEGs for the NFTs are stored. And then there are functions that allow you to set data, for example, the set URI function, which allows you to change where the metadata and the JPEGs for your contract are stored. Now, the first function you should allow anybody to call because anybody should be able to look up the details of an NFT. But the second function, you don't just want random people walking in off the internet and changing the Bored Apes Yacht Club contract to not point at Bored Ape pictures anymore, but to point at dodgy pictures on some sleazy website instead. That would upset all the holders of Bored Ape Yacht Club NFTs. So you make that second function, the set URI function, something called ownable. You pull in a standard library from OpenZeppelin that has been peer reviewed many, many times, and you make that set URI function ownable, and then only the owner of the contract can change it. And the reason why smart contract developers use ownable is because initially, when you deploy a contract, you're not 100% sure that it's going to run perfectly, and you have a number of functions that, for example, can help you rescue things if something goes wrong. So you might have an emergency withdraw all funds from this contract function, so that if the smart contract goes wrong, it doesn't trap hundreds or thousands of Ether in itself. The developer has the opportunity to call this emergency function, withdraw all the funds, and return them to their rightful owners manually, and then shut down the project. But of course, at some point, when it looks like the contract is safe and sound, you expect the developer to renounce ownership of the contract. You expect them to call a function that says, I no longer own this contract. I no longer am the person who can call these ownable functions. The owner of the contract is now the zero address, i.e. nobody, and those functions can now no longer be used. And then people feel secure that the contract can no longer be maliciously drained of its funds. At least they should feel that way. Of course, in practice, most people haven't got a clue what's going on in smart contracts and are completely oblivious to all the risks and all the powers that smart contract developers may have over those smart contracts. And this particular developer had slipped these 12 characters into the ownable.sol library, which meant that when it was checking if it was the owner of the contract that was calling a function, it didn't just allow the current owner of the contract to call that function, it also allowed that developer's address to call that function of the contract. And that meant that even if the ownership of the contract was renounced, set equal to nobody, that developer would still always secretly, or now not so secretly, be able to call all these functions. And that's a bad thing. Some of the functions in the contracts allow the owner to withdraw funds, and that means this developer will always be able to maliciously drain the funds of these various contracts that they deployed. Now, the sneaky thing is that they stuck it in a standard library. And when you go to somewhere like Etherscan to look at the code, typically, if it's been submitted for review, which it has been in all these contracts cases, the libraries that have been pulled in are shown in separate blocks. And developers won't go and look at those because these are standard libraries. You expect them to contain the standard content that OpenZeppelin provides. However, for this particular set of contracts, they don't. One of them has been maliciously altered. And in fact, the code change is very similar to the code change that was made for sleep minting NFTs. It does a similar thing. I have an article on it on LinkedIn, how it works. But again, you just sneak a little bit of extra code or an extra few characters into the existing code where it checks whether or not someone is allowed to do something. So, and it says, or I can do it too. It's really that simple. So what can we learn from this? Well, firstly, if you're going to run a smart contract project, you can't completely outsource all your technical stuff to some anonymous person that you found on Fiverr. And this should be blindingly obvious. I mean, banks don't go and hire anonymous developers on Fiverr in order to develop their database back-end software where they keep track of the balances of all their clients. And it should be pretty obvious to you why they don't do this, because an anonymous developer developing your financial infrastructure can put backdoors in the software, sneak stuff past you, and then later defraud you. And this is why banks will go off and use a recognized accredited company that's listed on a stock market where all the information about the company, who runs it, who owns it, who works there, is public knowledge, and where the company has a reputation that they won't want to lose by putting sneaky backdoors in software handling finances. And so the same applies to your smart contract projects on things like Ethereum and Binance Smart Chain and Polygon and stuff like that. You should not be hiring an anonymous developer to do sensitive work for you. You should be hiring developers who you know who they are, you know where you can find them, and they have a reputation that they want to uphold. Otherwise, you're taking an immense risk, not just with your own money, but with all the money of the users who come on board your project and start putting their funds into it too. It's just sheer negligence to take that approach. So the second question then is, well, what can be done about this person? Well, if they're anonymous, it's going to be hard to find them, and they can just change their name on Fiverr and start doing exactly the same thing again. So I don't really know what recourse the people running this project are going to have. There should be some legal recourse, because what has happened here is malicious, and it should be explainable to a judge with the help of an expert. But I guess we're just going to have to see what happens. I imagine what will happen is some of the projects will just keep blindly moving along. Some of the projects will close down their existing contract and migrate onto a new one that has hopefully been better checked and audited. There's another thing. You should get auditors to check your code. But it's quite possible that auditors would have missed this one too, because they have a certain amount of money handed to them to audit the code, and they have a certain amount of time to do it in, and the standard libraries that have been included in the code are probably the last thing they're going to look at. Although maybe because of this incident, that will change. Anyway, I've been going on quite a long time for this topic, given that it is actually such a simple thing, but hopefully the analogy of why banks don't hire random people off Fiverr to do the work for them goes some way to explaining what the real underlying issue is here. I hope you found this interesting, and I'll see you all in the next video soon. Bye for now.